So I'm Martin Weller. I'm a professor of education technology at the Open University in the OU in the UK. I've been a blogger for about 6 years now, I think. And as I said to someone recently, it was the best decision I ever made in my academic career. So, and what I do in my blog, I don't know if any of you read it, is I kind of really think about changes to technology that. To changes to higher education that technology bring. And so I've kind of been writing this book without realising I was writing this book for a while. And then I thought it'd be nice to kind of wrap it all up into books. I'm really interested in kind of what the impacts of new technologies are, so how they are changing practice, and both how they could change practice, and what the kind of implications of that are, for good or for bad as well. I think, like a lot of people, I went through a kind of evangelist phase. And I think a lot of people go evangelist and then they go complete kind of pessimist. And so I'm trying to tread out a careful line between the two, you know, and keep it balanced and offer a kind of balanced perspective. But at the same time, kind of really thinking about it. So are slides there yet for people yet?
53 seconds until they're loading. But if everybody else is, we got some yes and some no. How interesting. Now is the time for you to carry the conversation while we're waiting for that to change. Because I just did that for like 20 minutes.
Hold on a minute. Let me just grab something. I don't know if people have seen, but I put the contents, my activities for this week, up on my blog. I think they have appeared in the MOOC as well, but not in the right order and not always there. So that's just easy. So if you go into that link, you can follow it through. So all the kind of various activities I put. Because Dave warned me that I was overloading. When I first prepared my stuff this week, I had about 20 different activities. They said that's too much. So I've kind of slimmed it down from what I was going to do. So I'm really only looking at three things, which are: what is digital scholarship? And you can choose between teaching and research, or you can do both, and then some of the criticisms of digital scholarship.
I want to make it really clear that I'm the nice facilitator. as the other two guys aren't here right now, I can accuse them pretty much of whatever I like. We've got a couple of failed loads. We've got a bunch of people who can see the slides. So, you know, as we're 21 minutes into the session at this point, why don't we just go ahead and start, Martin? If you can see your slides.
Yeah.
Those of us who can't see them yet, I'm sure that we'll get there soon enough, and the rest of us can catch up when you get there. Go ahead.
Okay. So the outline of this talk is I want to look a bit about, you know, what is digital scholarship without getting too bogged down in definitions, where it comes from in the work of scholarship. I'm just going to take one aspect, which is that of research, but if you've seen my book, you know that I kind of explore four particular aspects. A topic that always comes up, it's kind of like some unwritten law, you know, if whenever two or three academics are gathered together and discuss digital scholarship, the conversation will turn to how you recognise it. So I want to talk a bit about that, about promotion and tenure and all that kind of stuff. If we get time, we can talk about this idea, who's turned it back? This idea of network weather, and relate to that the idea of changing nature conferences and perhaps some conclusions. There's quite a lot to pack in the remaining 40 minutes, but let's go for it. So what is digital scholarship? My philosophy friends will probably beat me up about this, but I think Wittgenstein made an argument that it's very difficult to come up with the definition of a game, and yet we all know what a game is, but as soon as you start trying to define one, you can say, well, this should be in there, this shouldn't be in there, and so it becomes very difficult. But yeah, we have a kind of innate sense of what one is, and so some things are kind of more closely aligned to this archetypal representation. So I kind of don't want to get too bogged down in that. We could spend the next, not only the next 40 minutes, the next 40 years trying to come up with a definition. And I think Dave, like me, was part of the group that was in around with learning objects. And I was into learning objects for 4 or 5 years, along with people like Dave Wiley, and just about every bloody conference you went to would spend ages going, but what is a learning object? And I think we haven't got anywhere. So, just briefly, I think digital scholarship is actually a shorthand, really. The digital bit isn't the only bit that's interesting. It's a shorthand for these three things coming together. So you've got digital content, and that's really important because it means it can be shared as the same stuff, so audio, video, text, whatever, it doesn't care what it is. So it can be shared over the same network. So then you have this, you know, the internet, so you can just pass the stuff around freely, and layer on top of that, you have a social network, so people kind of are beginning to form their own filters. But I think perhaps the most important aspect is this thing of openness, and that's both an approach, a kind of a mindset, but also it relates to things like a kind of democratization of the space. So, you know, a blog is a kind of very archetypal technology, I think, kind of represents all three of these things. I think it's at this intersection of these three things you begin to get kind of transformative practice. Are my slides changing, by the way, as I go through them here? So if we want a definition that you can then argue about, pick the pieces, I think this just question is really about trends using all aspects of scholarly practice. So it's not just about research or teaching something. As a result of the application of digital networks and open technologies, and importantly, the associated practices that go with them. So that's my kind of definition. Someone keeps sending my slides back. Is that you, Dave? So if we want to pull out some questions maybe for discussion later, one is this definition adequate, or does it even make sense? You don't have to answer that now. So what I do in the book, and I think a kind of good place to start, is Ernst Boyer did this review of scholarship back in the 90s. I think he looked at sort of something like 5,000, it was US academics, what it is they do. And he was trying to really, I think, raise the profile of teaching in particular, because, you know, the idea was, and actually still persists, and is true, that researchers kind of walk taller than everyone else. But he said, so what he was trying to say, what is it that they actually do? So I've analysed all the kind of daily tasks that scholars do in universities, and said, what is it they're doing? And he came up with these four categories. So discovery, which is kind of synonymous with kind of genesis research, really, kind of discovering new knowledge. Integration is kind of applying that across domains, really, so interdisciplinary work. Application is taking that knowledge and applying it to kind of maybe industry, or putting it into work and that kind of stuff. And then there's teaching. He said all four of these things are important and should carry equal weight. And so what I do in the book is I kind of try and take each of those and just look at one example of how digital scholarship is kind of affecting it. Now, the Boyer view isn't without its complications. Not everyone agrees with it, and some say it's a kind of very humanities-based approach and stuff. So it's not perfect, but I think it's a reasonable way to start thinking about it. I think there's a kind of interesting tension at the moment in digital scholarship. On the one hand, you've got kind of great innovation that's happening because the technology allows us to do it. Now, we couldn't be running this open course, you know, 10, 20 years ago. We maybe could have done, but there's a number of free tools out there, everyone's networks, we can just pick it up there. And also there's kind of a mindset that we can just go and do this kind of stuff. So there's kind of amazing innovation happening, and it's happening across, we couldn't have done it on TV really, could we? We would have had to have our own TV channel. That's the whole thing. It's kind of, we own the space now. So I just commented on a comment there. So in research, there's kind of amazing innovation going on and stuff. And at the same time, there's a very conservative, this is taking place in a very kind of conservative framework, and we'll come to that later. So there's this real kind of tension of two things pulling together. And it's maybe not always a creative tension or a healthy tension, but I think it's a theme that kind of comes out repeatedly. So we'll kind of return to that as we go on. So I'm just going to talk about research, but I said I could have chosen any one of those four Boyer things. This is a picture of me being depressed. Recently I went through a whole raft of... there's been a lot of reports out recently about looking at researchers' use of technology, and they all kind of come up with the same picture, which is basically it's a very conservative uptake out there. Yeah. But those are 3D glasses as well. Not even 3D glasses could cheer me up. So I'm just going to go through some of these themes and pull out some of the quotes. So this one says, a majority of researchers are making occasional use of these, well, you know, if you want a better word, Web 2.0 tools. But frequent or intensive use is rare, and some researchers regard blogs, wikis, and other novel forms of communication as a waste of time or even dangerous. This report, all these references are in the book, so you can pick them out if you want. Who's done that? Who keeps sending my thing back? So these people described researchers being generally kind of risk averse and behind the curve in using digital technology, which I think is an interesting finding. I think this report was the one that looked at new researchers, and they found there's no evidence to suggest they were kind of these tech-savvy young graduate students kind of back in traditional publishing practice. They were being very conservative, and we'll come back later. That's because that's more or less what they're told to do if they want to kind of get on. And the same report said, advice given to pre-tenure scholars was consistent across all fields, focus on publishing in the right venues, the proper impact journals, and avoid spending too much time on public engagement, all this other stuff, blogging, you know, all that. Don't waste your time, that's not going to get you tenure. This paper was looking at researchers and the kind of networks they form, and they said they tend to form a strong network of friends, which they meet through conferences and people they work with. So even there, kind of the social network and stuff wasn't really having much of an impact. This was an article in Nature. This guy was saying, talking about scientists and blogging. He's saying it's kind of really antithetical to the way many scientists are trained. You know, the whole point of blogging is to be spontaneous and just get your ideas out there quickly. And to a scientist, that's not how they work. It's not how they've been trained. So I think overall what that creates is a kind of negative context, which it's kind of saying new people come into the industry, come into a sector, and are immediately encouraged to kind of abandon any innovation and that kind of practice. And that seems to me the kind of converse of what happens in other industries. In other industries, you recognise kind of new blood as being the place where new ideas come from. And we say, for God's sake, don't do any of that new stuff, become like us. So the only people who can innovate are professors with tenure, and even the idea of tenure is a kind of disappearing fast. So you've got a very closed pool, maybe, of innovation. And that strikes me as quite a dangerous thing for researchers to be in. This is me getting a bit into advantage this moment, I'm sorry. I think one of the things about this is that research is really about control, and what you're often trying to do in research is say, we want to keep everything, control everything, apart from one variable which will change, and then we can say these are the outcomes. And so you're very training as a researcher is about controlling stuff, and a lot of these kind of new technologies are about letting go of control. You know, if you put your content out, you don't know whether anyone's going to view it, you don't know if someone's going to take it and, you know, make a parody of it and laugh in your face, or whether people are going to take it and make great stuff about it, and it's very kind of unpredictable. Jonathan Zittrain has this term, and that's about generativity, and it's that generativity when you kind of get unexpected innovation that kind of makes it really useful and amazing. And John Norton calls it a machine for springing surprises, and I think that kind of goes against a lot of our ethos as researchers. So one of the things I want to think about is how might digital scholarship affect research. So we know currently, I mean, people are doing stuff. I don't want to paint a completely kind of negative picture, but there is a kind of conservative context, I think. So I think one of the things that might happen is, as we begin to use technology, is our concept of what constitutes a piece of research begins to change. I don't say it disappears. I think you can have many different things, many different forms of granularity. But at the moment, it's kind of, we tend to think of a piece of research as an article or a book. But I think as we have different outputs, we might begin to think about that as, is a blog post a piece of research, or is given a presentation online, is a slideshare presentation a piece of research? So maybe our concept of what forms a piece of research begins to change, just because there are many different alternatives. And later, I think we get a kind of pushback from the outlets. Suddenly we've got these different outlets available to us, such as a blog or Twitter or whatever you want to use. So this is my colleague Tony Hurst's blog, O Useful Info. And Tony kind of, on a daily basis, kind of spends half an hour, an hour, kind of might do three or four posts a day of like, here's some data I've found, I've put it through this data visualization tool, I've got these outputs. Maybe I could go and do this. It's kind of an ongoing dialogue, really, with experimentation that he's doing. So, and it doesn't wrap any of that up into a journal article, but because he has the blog itself, it allows him to do that and allows him to have that output, I think. So the very nature of the media begins to influence what you think of and what you do and what you practice. I think there'll be new methodologies available. So I mean, crowdsource is an obvious one. I think people often kind of overestimate, you know, the use of crowdsourcing and for instance, how many empty wikis have we all created that kind of sit there and nobody ever contributes to. But even so, there are very good crowdsourced projects out there, and so it's a new methodology and these are things that can work. New connections. I mentioned previously, you know, they found that most researchers tend to have formed their networks by going to conferences and people they know and that kind of stuff. But I began to form my networks, I expect lots of people here, through online connections. And often I haven't met these people. I've met Dave for the first time this year and George. But they're kind of, it almost doesn't matter whether you meet them or not, that you kind of have enough connection with these people to kind of be able to work with them. And because research, the nature of research is changing, you know, I can do this for free or an evening for them, you know, and they can run a course for free because they know the people contribute and stuff. So you form these kind of light connections that don't require you to kind of sit on a keynote conference circuit and spend all your time traveling around the world. Traveling around the world's nice, but it takes time. I think analytics is going to be very interesting. I mean, I'm sure all of us kind of run Google Analytics, and it's fun looking at, you know, where have the people come to my blog from and stuff. But I think increasingly we'll start to put this kind of stuff into research proposals. We'll say, you know, we expect to get these number of visits from these locations, and we want our bounce rate to be X, and we want people to spend this amount of time. But also, we'll start to look at it and say, you know, actually the thing we thought was really interesting isn't the thing that people are linking to and reading, it's this bit over here, and that tells us something about our own research. So I don't think we've even begun to scratch the surface of how we build analytics into our own research. One idea that I would like to explore but haven't really done so yet is the idea of what's called cultural stickiness. So I think a lot of people do, when you come online, particularly when I started blogging, there's a kind of a culture of blogging, you know, so you're meant to reciprocate to people, you comment on other people's blogs, you know, the idea is you share quickly. And I think the same thing applies to Twitter, you know, there's a kind of, you retweet people and quote them and stuff, and you use it, the whole kind of etiquette builds up. So it's a very interesting question to be explored, is like, so if we begin to take on these other cultural norms, how do they intersect with the cultural norms of our discipline? So perhaps a crude way to put it would be, do bloggers in different disciplines, say a humanities blogger and a science blogger, have more in common now than a blogger and a non-blogger in the same discipline? Because that cultural stickiness begins to kind of override your discipline norms. I don't know the answer to that, but I think it's interesting. So, and the thing we might think about is, so what is research? So in the UK, we have this exercise called REF, the Research Excellence Framework, which is run by the government and is a horrible waste of everyone's time. But so that's quite a conservative process, and that defines it as a process of investigation leading to new insights effectively shared. There's nothing in that definition that says shared through journal articles or stuff. You know, it insights effectively shared. So I think, for instance, you'd be hard-pushed to say that Tony Hurst's blog doesn't meet that definition of research. It's investigation leading to new insights which are effectively shared. And to get back onto the evangelist thing, I'm kind of worried that if the researchers tend to sit and say, we won't engage in stuff until it's been proven to be useful. Whereas I think, you know, we should be leading in this and saying that we think there's something interesting in this stuff. It's all about communication, knowledge construction. And these are things that we do all the time. And why wouldn't we be interested in it? I think we're in danger of having nothing to say if we don't do that. But I realise people might disagree. So the question we might have started, is our researchers right to be aware of new technology? You know, perhaps if we don't want to jump to every new technology. Remember, you know, 20 years ago we might have said, yeah, laser disc is the way forward. You know, and where would we be now? So to come on to Tony and the World, there's a very shady character there. As I said, this topic kind of nearly always arises. And I think it's interesting because it's a good example of that kind of tension that's within digital scholarship. So generally, promotion is seen as a three-legged stool. It's teaching, research, and what's called service, admin, that kind of stuff. And some people have four or five, but it's kind of generally those three things. And as someone said, the research leg of that stool is longer than the others. So the question is, how do we recognise digital scholarship? We kind of know how to recognise those things, but are we kind of do the square peg and the round hole thing with digital scholarship? To go back to some of those reports and stuff that I was reading earlier, so someone said, enthusiasm for development and adoption of technology should not be conflated with the hard reality of tenure and promotion requirements in highly competitive and complex professional environments. So we can experiment with new genres, but they don't really have, it's taking place in a very conservative value and reward system that have peer review at their kind of core. This one says, while this community talks about publication, language used implies that digital scholarship is of significantly lesser value. And the word of mouth to the young ones is, don't do it, you're wasting your time. And I think one of the problems is that often the people who sit on the kind of central, there's a kind of a human factor about all this, the people who sit on central promotion committees are often quite senior people and have got there through being very traditional, so they kind of know what a good publication record looks like. As someone at my university said, being a scholar is about sitting in a library with dusty journals, goddamn it, that's what it is for him. And so, by the time you put a research proposal in front of them, a promotion case in front of them, they know what a good publication record is like. They haven't got the faintest clue, and maybe we don't have the faintest clue either, of what a good blogging track record looks like. I did that photo on that slide, by the way. But they're not my toys. I think another thing that's happened is that we kind of outsourced evaluation in a way, particularly when it comes to research. We decided research is so specialised, these kind of central committees couldn't possibly judge people's work and say this is a good piece of research in medieval religious history, because we've got no idea about that. So what they actually did was outsourced it to publications and presses and said, we don't know what a good research in this area looks like, but we know if you've published in a journal with an impact factor, we'll take that as a proxy for good research. And what that's done is it's put the publishers in a strong position of power, because now in order to get publication, in order to get promotion, you need to kind of be published in the things that are recognised. But there is a kind of a good move, particularly in humanities, I think, about trying to recognise digital scholarship. There are different ways people try to do this. One is a kind of very traditional thing, just let's try and find digital equivalents. If you've done, the first, the kind of breaking of the walnut one was like, we will accept online journals are as good as paper journals. But I think people are beginning to do more than that. They can say, okay, perhaps a measure of impact here is that, if you have this many hits on a YouTube video, that's kind of, or it gets that begins to get cited, that equals a kind of a measure of an impact, perhaps the same as giving a keynote. Another move is kind of just to generate general guidelines so that people say, these are the type of things you need to look at for digital scholarship and to have them formally recognised. An approach I think needs to be used in partnership with lots of other things and wouldn't work on its own is to start using metrics. So every year in my staff appraisal, not that anyone ever pays any attention to it, but I like to put in my blog stats, my SlideShare stats, and just say, look, this is stuff that I'm doing, and X thousand people read it and this kind of stuff, and so does that count for something? Because it's interesting, at the university we've got a repository for journal articles, and every month we kind of get a monthly kind of top 10 list, and usually the winner is like someone who has like 50 or 100 downloads to their paper that month, and anyone who runs a good blog or site knows you'll get several hundred hits a day, and you think, so it's why is that data good and this data over here not useful? But I don't want to go too far down the metrics thing, because what you wouldn't want is to be like, you need to get a technoarchy rating of 100 and then you automatically become a senior lecturer, because that just becomes to kind of gaming. Peer assessment, I think, will become increasingly important. So I mentioned it, if we don't know what a good blogging record is, perhaps we'll say, look, we can't outsource, we haven't got the equivalent of a journal here, but we're going to get in people who we do respect and get them to analyse this work and take their recommendation. Microcredit might be another thing, 50 blog posts equals one paper, it'd be a difficult kind of thing to do, but I think particularly in research they begin to talk about kind of micro publication and stuff, and so it goes back to the idea of breaking down the granularity again. And lastly, I think we could just try and all these things, I think the first approach to this, they're all trying to map current approaches on digital scholarship, and we could come up with different ways of doing it. I don't know what they would look like, but that's the point of finding different ways. So Stephen Heppel has this really good quote. He says, we continually make the error of subjugating technology to our present practice rather than allowing it to free us from the tyranny of past mistakes, which is a grandiose statement. I think we're kind of in danger of doing that with how we recognise digital scholarship. We're just going to try and force it into the existing holes rather than thinking, what can we do that's really new with it? It's given us all this data, for instance. How can we take that and analyse that? So a question that we might want to think about is, do you think we should formally recognise digital scholarship? But I do know some people who say, it's fine, you do it on the side, and what it actually does is it raises your profile in the traditional stuff, it gets you to give keynote speeches, which we kind of accept as evidence. He gets you to give publications, all that kind of stuff. So lastly, on this idea of network weather, which I think is a nice metaphor. So I've kind of often tried to not play the card that you must get into digital scholarship. There's a big sort of tidal wave coming towards you. If you don't not doing it now, you're going to be swept away. Universities will be irrelevant, all that kind of stuff. I think people kind of really overplay that card. And often they end up talking about digital natives, and then you know that they've completely lost the track. But I think network weather is an interesting kind of metaphor. So it comes from Adam Greenfield. And he had this kind of scenario. He's interested in kind of ambient technology and how social networks impact upon the way we live in cities. So he says, you know, this guy comes into a bar next to you, and you've had a really good hard day at work, you want to have a drink. And he had a G&T, and he paid less with G&T than you did, because he's the mayor of this place on Foursquare. And then 10 minutes later, it's all filling up with his mates, because he's sort of gone out to Twitter and said, I'm here getting cheap drinks. They're all piling in there. So you think, oh, I'm going to leave this place. And you go down the road to a little Italian place, and so that's closed down, because you've got some bad reviews online, or someone Google bombed it, or whatever. And so if you don't know what's going on around here, you won't have the foggiest idea about why your evening turned out the way it did. And so it's kind of like the weather, it's just happening to you, you don't have any control over it. And I think you can take this analogy for a lot of academic life. So think about how network weather impacts on teaching, and I'll talk about conferences in a minute, but authoring, so teaching for example, even if you're not into this stuff, there's some smart aleck kid sitting in the back of a lecture watching exactly the same subject you're talking about, except he's watching the kind of world expert from Stanford give a talk and actually now asking you really tricky questions that you don't know anything about. Or if you're an author, you suddenly find that actually people are forming networks together and they're writing papers together and you're excluded from it because all these debates are going online and they're kind of forming networks with that. Talk about conferences. I think conferences are kind of interesting. They kind of sit at the heart of academic practice because they're kind of our chance to get away and have a jolly, really. And so I think the kind of nature of the network weather thing kind of really applies to conferences. So even if you're not into it, they're beginning to change. 15 minutes, okay, then I can do it now. So the idea of the amplified conference, so, you know, where people will be tweeting about it or blogging about the conference, and that will be bringing in people from outside who aren't at the conference. You might be sitting in a conference and suddenly the speaker starts getting really hard questions because there's a kind of a bit gone around in the back channel that he doesn't know what he's talking about, or people are bringing in questions from outside and stuff. And then there's kind of moving to completely online conferences. I ran the OU conference online last year, and it was really interesting. We kind of have an annual conference every year. The same people kind of turned up every year. We thought, let's do something different. So we run it completely open, completely online. So we've got a completely different audience in, and we managed to get people like Jimmy Wales was our keynote speaker because he managed to do an hour's presentation while he was waiting in between planes at Heathrow, which so we couldn't have got him to come and speak to us kind of live, but we managed to get him anyway. So I think, so suddenly you start going to conferences and you think, why isn't anyone turning up to the official do? Well, it's because they all decided on Facebook that they're going to go to this bar down the road, and that's where it's going to be. So the nature of conference will be changing even though you might not be involved in it. I think that's a good example of network weather. And if you think about the conference archive, think about just 10 years ago even, it was probably just going to be a CD-ROM of the articles, which you would probably never look at. And now, there might be a Flickr archive, and people don't need to agree to create a Flickr archive, they'll just use the kind of hashtag, and you can then find all the photos relating to a particular conference. If there's a Twitter hashtag, then there'll be that kind of informal dialogue that goes on around it. People might have videos or presentations, there may be a related social networks, just name, people will be live blogging it or whatever. So suddenly you've got this much richer archive of what's going on around a conference than it used to be. But there is this thing, and this is an example of that tension I talked about, what I've called the conference conservative cycle. So in order to get a conference viable, you need people to come and they need to pay fees. In order to attend, people need to get funds from the university or a project. And to justify this, they usually need to give a presentation and be given a paper. And it often needs to be peer-reviewed or kind of decent, then put it on the CV. They'll only attend conferences that offer this. So you kind of end up with this very conservative cycle of conferences. I mean, you could be doing lots of other things. In some ways, we kind of really waste conferences. Being face-to-face is great. So we can do all the kind of presentation stuff like this online. When we get together, we should do some really good stuff that you can only do when you're face to face, rather than just sitting there and delivering material and broadcasting to people. But we are beginning to see kind of alternative formats, the kind of bar camp format, so when people get together and decide what they're going to do one day, and the next day kind of go off in groups and do it. Pre-presentation, so you say, this is my presentation, look at the slides or whatever, and then actually in my face-to-face session, I'm going to discuss the issues. People can vote about things they want to talk about, so maybe you have 50 possible presentations, we're going to vote on the top 10. Or people say, let's get together, instead of, you know, just talking about stuff and not doing anything, we're going to sit together and actually produce something. That could be an open educational resource or whatever. So my question that we might discuss is, would you attend a non-traditional conference, or could you attend one? Would you get funding to do it? Or would they say, that doesn't sound like proper work? Okay, so what does all this mean? I think we've seen something of a failure of ownership in scholarship in general. So I mentioned kind of outsourced recognition of research to the press. We gave up a lot of our university presses and now have to buy stuff back from them. You may think that I've got something against publishers. And similarly with VLEs, we kind of gave up a lot of our technology and teaching to these kind of commercial companies. And I think we need to make sure we don't do a similar failure of ownership when it comes to digital scholarship. And I think the key to that is to engage the technology. Even if you're not kind of, you don't necessarily have to be a kind of enthusiast for it and think it's going to solve your problems, but I think you have to, I think dismissing it to kind of just allows other people to come in, particularly commercial entities to come in and take over. I'm nothing against commercial entities, often it's kind of very beneficial relationship, but we kind of need to know what we want to do. I think there is a kind of potential to radically change practice, and I think the examples I gave of how the nature of research might change as a result of taking on kind of digital technologies, I think is interesting to how we perceive and do research could well change. I think we ought to kind of be happy as well. These are quite exciting times to live in, I think, as a scholar. I know it's incredibly depressing, the world's going down the pan and we're all going to be unemployed and stuff. Apart from that, it's actually quite exciting because there's still change and we've got the chance to kind of take hold of how we do some stuff for this. So there's a quote here from the English author Martin Amis, and he's talking about the sexual revolution. He says, it was a revolution. We all know what happens in a revolution. You see what goes, you see what stays, and you see what comes. And I think the challenge for us, as people who might want to think of ourselves as digital scholars, is not that we see what comes, but we determine what goes, what stays, and what comes. So we decide what's important to us, and we decide what we can change and what makes it better. So my last question is, have I convinced you that digital scholarship was worth considering, and that you should read my book? And there it is. Although I see Julia's online, so really you should read the full manga version when she gets around to it. So that's me. I'm going to stop there and allow other people to talk.
That was great, Martin. Thanks a lot. That was a really, really painless journey through 53 slides. I don't think I've ever seen anybody do that before. That was great. I think for me, at least, it's done some really nice contextualizing in terms of what you're trying to say. I think in terms of, as we have 8 minutes, I'd rather see people throw questions in the chat room because I don't think we're going to have enough time to manage the people's audio and that kind of stuff. So let's take the first question there, if you don't mind, Martin. Can you clarify how digital scholarship fits with or is different from internet research and TEL? In other words, to what extent is this term becoming more widely known? How does it fit into traditional disciplines?
Okay, I'll try to answer that. I'm not sure I will. It's a strange term. So it's gained a bit of currency recently, but it has different interpretations. So it's got a very library-focused interpretation. It's about digital curation and looking after stuff. So I'm using it here in a kind of much broader sense, which I hope I conveyed. It's kind of about changes across the board. So I think, you know, TEL is part of it. You know, it's about... that's kind of how we think about it, might do things in teaching and stuff. But I think digital scholarship is much more about what it means to be a scholar and all those things we think of as doing as part of our scholarly practice. And we can argue about who's a scholar and who isn't as well. I think another interesting thing is that digital scholarship breaks down those boundaries. So you could be a very good digital scholar and not actually be associated with a university. But I think I've kind of kept university as my main kind of focus, just to kind of keep it there. But so yeah, I think it's a much kind of broader thing than TEL, but that would be part of it. Do you want to answer the question?
And really, there's a couple more sort of follow-up questions there that kind of follow up nicely on that. Is there a danger of too much focus on digital scholarship can undermine efforts to make it mainstream, and how has your writing changed if it has? Do you code switch now? That's a really nice question about code switching as well.
Okay, yeah, I'm not sure, again, I'm not sure I'll answer the question, I'll just speak and then I don't think there's an answer somewhere. It definitely changed my writing style. So, the first chapter of the book, I think it's worth looking at because I compare the last book I wrote with this book and kind of just the process of writing it was very different. So when I came to write this book, I kind of went back over my blog. So you've kind of been gathering this stuff as you go along because you keep a track of everything. And so I estimate that I had about kind of 30,000 words from the blog that I could put into the book. But when I did that, I soon realized I needed to change the tone of that. You write on a blog very differently. It's kind of much chattier. You know, it's kind of like, and I'm a bit of an idiot and I've just done this and stuff. And I think that tone doesn't quite work in a book. The book could still be quite informal. I think it's not a stuffy, formal academic book, but the tone changes. In terms of kind of code switching, because at the Open University I've got a very formal role as well, so I have to kind of get engaged with things like the ref and, you know, all kind of very formal OU systems and that. But I do, you know, it's often, I did a presentation once or a blog post about openness, catch my disease. It is one of those things that you've been thinking almost in everything. I'm like just a broken record. I don't actually need to turn up to meetings because all that I need to say is like, well, taking the openness route, we could do it like this, you know, and you begin to see it kind of how it relates to everything. And in the book, I have this Saul Bellow quote, which is from The Adventures of Augie March. He says, we all know there's no accuracy to suppression. If you hold down one thing, you hold down the adjoining. And I think the reverse is true with digital scholarship. It's like you liberate one thing and you liberate the adjoining. So suddenly, as soon as you begin to scratch the surface about publication, it's like, well, if we're going to allow open access publishing, why shouldn't we be thinking about blogs over here? And if we're going to remove the filter, then why aren't we recognising this? And suddenly everything begins to unravel, and so it affects almost every part of your practice.
There's one more question there I think we have time for. I want to make one comment first, and then I'll serve you up a softball as the last question, Martin. First, I want to thank everybody for coming out and for participating in the chat room. It's been fantastic today. It's been a lot of fun following in the background. Much thanks to Barry Dahl and for coming out and helping us facilitate here today and giving us access to this room, which has been really solid and helped us continue this discussion. 77 people in here today. I think we had a nice discussion. For those of you who are wondering how to participate, I know Jane Wild made some comment in there. Write something. Find a place to write. Find a place to respond. Martin has given us some really nice prompts to start from, and then post it up and tag it with Change11 somewhere on Twitter, somewhere where you can find it, and somebody should take the responsibility of responding to you. The more you can participate with each other, the more those groups will form, the communities will form, and things will work out. The last question I want to serve up to Martin, how does this change the students' participation in the educational process? And this is a question I'm sort of pulling out of a couple of comments. You know, if I can go out and read my prof's blog, both as a prospective student and also as an engaged student, how does that change the way that I interact with my prof when I can go out there and comment on their articles, on their blog?
It's an interesting question, actually. So the nice answer is that it's great. It's a much more democratized space, and you kind of all chum together. But I also wonder whether, you know, I'm trying to think about when I was an undergrad. I think students are often quite a conservative, but I've used the word conservative a lot. Students are often quite a conservative group, actually. And often the kind of anecdotal evidence you get from, we try to get them to, we use loads of kind of Web 2.0 tools. Like, we don't want this stuff. You know, we're paying our money. Give us your crappy institutional VLE and stuff. So I do wonder whether they want to have maybe some of that distance. But certainly, I run some postgrad courses at the OU, and I got my students kind of just to sign up to Twitter at the start. I don't really get them starting with it, but just kind of get on board. And I think that works really well, because then only about half of them take to it, you know, but that's fine. But then when they go on elsewhere, it's like they remain part of your network. And I forget which ones are the students, which ones weren't. But you're beginning to give them a really good kind of network for their lives. And I think the, you know, we're trying to talk about digital literacies earlier, and I'm kind of ambivalent about digital literacies often, but I think if we were to have a digital literacy, it would be about how to form a really good network and be a valuable member of that network. That will be the most important thing you have in your life going forward, I think. And so just if your professors are part of that, your network, and you can call them, not call them, but just be part of that kind of general group. So you can see what they're thinking, and as you go on through your career, then you're just part of their network as well. And I think that will be a really valuable tool. You know, we often talk about, who is it who said the thing about, higher education is the only industry where we kind of throw a party when our customers leave us. And it's kind of, is that right? Keeping in contact with people and just kind of keeping them with you and stuff, and just allowing them to be part of that learning path as they go on as well. And if you don't just get to graduate, say, I'm never going to learn again. It's like you kind of keep with it. And I think, but it's also not hard work. But like, you don't want to be getting thousands of emails that you need to respond to every day. But the kind of light touch way of keeping networked, I think, is very important, very effective.
Thanks, Martin. For those of you who did not get your question answered, I encourage you to send Martin thousands of emails so that he can engage in that discussion with you. But more seriously, please post it on Twitter. I'm sure Martin won't mind if we send a couple of @mwellers, that's @mweller, and take your question from the chat room and pop it in there. Tag it with hashtag change11, change11, and then we'll all be able to track along with you. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Barry, thanks again for hosting. And that's us finished.